And I have a visual aid, as you can see. No sound, only me. Clichés. I'm going to define them only for the purpose of my paper, as words and phrases used repeatedly and often without much thought or intelligence, only for the point of my paper. Clichés have constituted the dominant means of understanding and commenting on translation since antiquity. The cliché may take the form of a dichotomy indicating opposed translation strategies, such as word for word versus sense for sense, which is given a decisive formulation in Jerome's letter to Pomachius in the year 395 of the Common Era. In some cases, the cliché may develop into a fully-fledged proverb about translation. A pithy statement that is believed to encapsulate an accepted truth, and therefore to be worthy of repeated application, whether in elite or in popular cultures, whether by the scholar or by the general reader. In this category belong catchphrases like traduttore, traditore, and poetry is what gets lost in translation, usually attributed to Robert Frost. Why formulaic expressions should be prevalent in translation commentary is not clear, at least initially. They are undoubtedly indicative of rote thinking. Although the repetitive use of concepts occurs in connection with other practices, it seems to be done so frequently with translation and with such negative expressions as to contribute to its continuing marginality. The practice attracts reductiveness, in other words, because it is assumed to be simplistic or mechanical, lacking the creative or conceptual sophistication that would require more complex explanation. Perhaps the problem is not so much rote thinking as a dearth of ideas. George Steiner has suggested that although, and I'm quoting from Steiner here, the literature on the theory, practice, and history of translation is large, the fact is that the number of original significant ideas in the subject remains very meager. Identical theses, familiar moves and refutations in debate recur, nearly without exception, from Cicero and Quintilian to the present. End of quote. If we follow Steiner's assessment of over two millennia of translation commentary, a sheer lack of intellectual innovation has led not only to the emergence of a body of conventional wisdom, but also to an excessive reliance upon it. In the absence of new concepts, it would seem formulaic expressions have acquired an explanatory power that merits their reiteration. I'm going to argue that this account is misleading. Not only does Steiner's assessment of the literature ignore significant differences across centuries of translation theory and practice, but it also fails to illuminate how translation, in particular, could have become dominated by rote thinking, and what is at issue in the recourse to conventional wisdom. To provide answers to these questions, we must interrogate long entrenched assumptions about translation that underlie proverbial statements, and not only proverbial statements. It will help to start with an examination of the proverb as a genre, and then to return translation proverbs to their originary contexts, where they are intended to express specific ideas and to serve particular rhetorical purposes. The aim is to defamiliarize notions that have come to be all too familiar as truths of translation, to show how they actually limit thinking about what translation is and does, and to indicate other, more productive directions that thinking can take. The proverb is a genre riven by contradiction. On the one hand, the form is structured for maximum rhetorical effectiveness through brevity and diverse kinds of repetition, acoustic, lexical, syntactical. Linguistic features like rhyme and alliteration, metrical regularity and parallel construction produce an effect that is simultaneously mnemonic and suasive. Not only do these features serve as an aid to memory, but they also, coupled with the brevity typical of proverbs, engineer a forceful closure that invests the content with the illusionistic appearance of truth, at once timeless and universal. The form of a proverb is thus characterized by invariance. The content, on the other hand, is both moralistic and disseminating. The proverb functions as a rule for conduct that rests uneasily on metaphorical substitution, through potentially unlimited applications in heterogeneous contexts. As a result, the meanings of the proverb multiply without end, eventually entering into contradiction and nonsense, preempting the illusionism of the form, its truth effect. The content of the proverb is thus characterized by variance. Let's take an example. OxfordDictionaries.com reduces this proverb to the abstraction that reflects most current use. I'm quoting here. If you sort out a problem immediately, it may save a lot of extra work later. Okay. This reduction turns the proverb into a metaphor, deferring its relation to any specific context while allowing it to be applied to infinite contexts. The formal features of the proverb, notably its brevity, its iambic regularity, its rhyme, produce the forceful closure that releases an illusionistic effect of truth, which is undermined by the sheer heterogeneity of countless applications. The range of fields where a stitch in time saves nine is applied, judging from both popular and specialized texts accessible on the internet, includes agriculture, business, chemistry, child welfare, finance, information technology, law, medicine, mining, and psychology. Even when surveyed within a single field, like medicine, the applications reveal such divergent meanings as to cast doubt not only on whether they bear any resemblance to each other, but also on whether the proverb itself makes any sense. Thus, a stitch in time has been used to describe both cosmetic surgery and bowel resection. Both sterilization as a method of birth control and chemotherapy for advanced lung cancer. Distinctions between surgical procedures that are elective, urgent, or emergency are effectively erased in these applications. Yet whether in the case of terminal illness, the proverb carries much meaning at all remains questionable. If the patient's life is no more than prolonged for a limited period, the notion of sorting out a problem turns out to be empty of significance. Or take the application to premarital medical examinations, which are treated as a means, I'm quoting from the website here, to safeguard and preserve the integrity as well as the sanctity of marriage as an institution. End of quote. Insofar as the article emphasizes the detection of sexually transmitted diseases, the checkup is unlikely to solve or mitigate a later marital problem. It may rather serve to preempt marriage altogether. When a proverb addresses the translator, or translation, curiously, its relationship to the genre changes. The formal invariance may persist, whether through brevity or repetitive structure or a combination of these features. When put to use, furthermore, the proverb is still reduced to an abstraction, which discloses its metaphoricity. Yet, the content is not variable. The proverb does not undergo an unlimited range of applications or translations in heterogeneous contexts. The context is always the same, the practice of translation, whether generalized to every time and place or applicable to a specific case. And in every application, at least from the 20th century onward, the proverb signifies the same basic meaning, untranslatability, or the impossibility of translation. Consider tradutore, traditore. Even though the proverb is Italian, the plural version, tradutori, traditori, was included in editions of the Oxford Dictionary of English Proverbs between 1935 and 1970, before appearing in more general reference works, a fact that attests to its widespread use in Anglophone writing. The dictionary adds a translation into English, Translators Traders, along with several illustrative passages that date from the 17th to the 20th centuries. One passage, as you can see here, drawn from a 1929 letter to the editor of the London Times, explains how personal visits to buyers abroad lead to successful trade relations with foreign countries. But visitor is advised not to rely on translation. Okay, I'll just read this out for you. The visitor ought to be able to speak fluently the language of the country visited. Working through an interpreter is roundabout and, in many cases, hopeless. As the Italian proverb says, traduttore, traditore. This use of the proverb shows a functioning in line with the genre, although with a significant deviation. It is employed as a conclusive explanation whose cogency is enforced by brevity, repetitive rhythm, and paronomasia. It is also reduced to an abstract meaning, namely, that translation is impossible, hopeless, which turns it into a metaphorical vehicle for this idea and enables its application to interpreting in commercial transactions. Yet at this stage, the proverb stops functioning as such. It lacks the proliferation and dissemination of meaning that typify the genre. The specificity of the context does not involve any further metaphorical substitution, any particular application to commerce or to interpreting. The proverb merely asserts the failure of translation, as if untranslatability were a timeless and universal truth. Although it is moralistic, moreover, it offers no viable rule for conduct, except implicitly a rejection of translation. The translator is doomed to fail because of the very nature of translation, a point that is driven home by the acoustic similarity between traduttore, traditore. The pun indicates that translation and treachery are one and the same. Some uses of this proverb can be more revealing of the theoretical assumptions on which it rests. Arthur Z, a contemporary Chinese-American poet, cites the proverb in the introduction to his translations of Chinese poetry, a mixture of classical and 20th century Chinese poets. So I'll read this out for you. I know translation is an impossible task, and I have never forgotten the Italian phrase, traduttori, traditori, translators, traitors. Which translation does not in some way betray its original? In considering the process of my own translation, I am aware of loss and transformation, of destruction and renewal. Although Z puts the word impossible within skeptical quotation marks, he nonetheless reduces the proverb to the idea that translation is impossible when he asks the rhetorical question, which translation does not in some way betray its original? The implicit answer, of course, is none. He then offers a glimpse of what betray might mean in this context through such general terms as loss, transformation, destruction, renewal. They all imply that the translator is trusted to leave the source text unchanged. But this trust is always betrayed insofar as translation necessarily causes change. These remarks point to a particular understanding or model of translation that I will call instrumental. It regards translation as the reproduction or transfer of an invariant contained in the source text, an essential form or meaning, which the translator ought to preserve intact, but never does because of the transformative nature of translation. The proverb assumes, but paradoxically forestalls, the viability of an instrumental model of translation. Thus, the formal and semantic invariance of traduttore, traditore, the punning proverb that refers only to translation, seems to be a reflection or a projection of a more fundamental concept, the assumption of formal and semantic invariance that is thought to characterize the source text in instrumentalism. When the proverb is cited in translation commentary that is more theoretically sophisticated, different models of translation might be put into play. So at the end of this 1959 essay, one of the most famous essays in the history of translation theory and commentary, actually, Roman Jakobson introduces the proverb, traditore, traditore, into his discussion of the untranslatability of poetry. So I'll read this out for you. This is at the very end of his essay. It's a short essay. The pun, or to use a more erudite and perhaps more precise terminology, a precise term, sorry, paronomasia, reigns over poetic art. And whether its rule is absolute or limited, poetry by definition is untranslatable. Only creative transposition is possible. Either intralingual transposition from one poetic shape into another, or interlingual transposition from one language into another, or finally intersemiotic transposition from one system of signs into another. For example, from verbal art into music, dance, cinema, or painting. If we were to translate into English the traditional formula, traditore, traditore, as the translator is a betrayer, we would deprive the Italian rhyming epigram of all its paronomastic value. Hence, a cognitive attitude would compel us to change this aphorism into a more explicit statement and to answer the questions, translator of what messages? Betrayer of what values? Remarkably, Jakobson's comments assume two mutually exclusive models of translation. On the one hand is instrumentalism. This assumption is first implied by his notion that poetry is untranslatable, and then exemplified by his treatment of the proverb. He uses it to illustrate the impossibility of reproducing what he takes to be a formal invariant, its paronomastic value, while tacitly demonstrating the truth of the proverb. Thus, both poetry and proverb are untranslatable because they contain invariant features that translation should reproduce or transfer, but fails to do so, insofar as the nature of translation is to change the source text. On the other hand, however, Jakobson also assumes a quite different model of translation that I'm going to call hermeneutic. This model regards translation as an interpretation that inevitably varies the form and meaning of the source text according to the translating language or medium. Hence, he proposes to solve the problem of untranslatability by resorting to what he calls creative transposition, which involves various kinds of changes, in poetic shape, in language, or in system of signs. Yet, the term creative transposition is misleading, because Jakobson refers to the same process as translation. He uses the word translation at the very beginning of his essay, where he first distinguishes among three ways of interpreting a verbal sign. Okay, so here's the classic distinction that he draws. You'll see he uses the word interpretation, and so no creative transposition. Okay. Now, I'm not going to read this, I'm just going to move on. Here's the point. Beneath the seemingly coherent exposition of Jakobson's essay slide two contradictory models of translation. One instrumental, stressing invariance, reproduction or transfer, and untranslatability. The other hermeneutic, stressing variation, interpretation, and translatability. The comment on the cognitive attitude. Let me go back so you can see that again. At the very end of the second paragraph. The comment on the cognitive attitude with which he closes the essay doesn't actually resolve this contradiction, since it can support both models. If the messages and values that are translated or betrayed are viewed as formal and thematic invariants contained in the proverb, or derived from its application to a particular case of translation, then the cognitive attitude would assume the instrumental model, although with the difference that the more explicit translation would be capable of communicating those invariants and hence validating instrumentalism. If, however, the messages and values are viewed as the result of an interpretation inscribed in the proverb or its application, one among various possible interpretations that fix its form and theme. Then, the cognitive attitude would assume the hermeneutic model, and the translation that transforms the proverb into a more explicit statement would be capable of communicating that interpretation to the exclusion of others. This indeterminacy shows that the distinction between instrumental and hermeneutic models of translation may seem to form a binary opposition. But on further scrutiny, any such opposition collapses to reveal the primacy of interpretation and its constitutive role in thinking about translation. Both models are heuristic in understanding translation, in understanding what translation is and does. They are models in the sense of conceptual constructions. And so instrumentalism, too, can be seen as a set of theoretical assumptions that underlie or give rise to a particular interpretation of translation practice. Yet, the impact of instrumentalist assumptions, both intellectual and practical, is insidious and costly. The assumption of formal and semantic invariance breaks off thinking about translation, in the same way that it breaks off, in the case of translation proverbs, the proliferation and dissemination of meaning that typify the proverb genre. Instrumentalism, to be more precise, preempts thinking about translation as an interpretive act that varies the source text, suppressing the assumption of the hermeneutic model of translation that can take into account this variance. Part two. The statement attributed to Robert Frost, "Poetry is what is or gets lost in translation," has been repeated so frequently as to become proverbial in translation commentary. It is pointedly phrased and rhythmical, bearing a formal resemblance to proverbs, even though it lacks the rhetorical force of traditore traditore. The statement also works like a proverb. When cited, it is reduced to an abstraction that discloses its status as a metaphor. Yet even before citation releases that abstraction, the word lost itself is metaphorical. Where exactly is the loss supposed to occur? The source text, if it contains poetry, never loses that feature. Despite being translated, it continues to exist without deprivation or destruction. Nothing can be lost from the translated text, of course, if the poetry never appeared there in the first place. The notion that the loss occurs during the translation process, the meaning that is usually assigned to the statement, constitutes a metaphor for non-translation or omission, although it neither describes nor explains what brings about these potential results. The metaphor of loss is moralistic, but unaccountable. It already conceals some concept of what translation is and ought to do, yet without making that concept explicit or allowing it to be inferred with any precision apart from specific context. Most citations, however, assume that the statement is self-explanatory. Some add interpretations that articulate what the commentators treat as an implicit abstraction. In a review of poetry translations, the British poet Christopher Reed, I guess that name means something here, right? Christopher Reed, agreed with Frost's statement and then proceeded to elucidate it by conceiving of poetry as a metaphysical essence. This is a quote from Reed. "We like to think that a poem, if it has any value, possesses a quiddity for which no other arrangement of words, let alone those in a foreign language, can be a sufficient substitute." End of quote. David Damrosch, in theorizing world literature as writing that gains in translation, that's a quote from Damrosch, resisted metaphysical thinking like Reed's, assigning Frost's statement to what he called purist views of literary language, and taking it as a reference to the difficulty of translating prosody. This is a quote from Damrosch. "Whatever meaning a new language can convey is irretrievably sundered from the verbal music of the original," End of quote. Damrosch, too, accepted Frost's statement, although he sought to qualify it. This is Damrosch again. It is more accurate to say that some works are not translatable without substantial loss, and so they remain largely within their local or national context, never achieving an effective life as world literature. End of quote. It would seem, then, that world literature cannot be reliably defined by reference to translated texts, but also that the category of world literature is less inclusive of poetry than other genres. Citations, such as those by Reed and Damrosch, aim to specify or refine what Frost said, but they nonetheless show that the metaphor of loss signifies the same basic meaning in every use. Poetry is untranslatable, whether completely or in varying degrees. Returning Frost's statement to its originary context can help to expose its theoretical assumptions. In a 1964 lecture, Louis Untermeyer, a longtime friend of Frost, reported the poet using it in a conversation where he expressed his distaste for an extended analysis of his 1923 poem, Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening. According to Untermeyer, Frost declared, I'm quoting here, this is a quote from Untermeyer's lecture, okay, "You've often heard me say, perhaps too often, that poetry is what is lost in translation. It is also what is lost in interpretation," end of quote. This report makes clear that Frost did not regard translation as an interpretive act, first of all. On the contrary, he saw translation and interpretation as two distinctly different practices that can be performed on a poem. In his view, both practices are deeply questionable because they entail an omission of poetry, a term that he did not define on this occasion. Since Untermeyer's quotation seems to have been made from memory, the extent to which he may have edited or revised what Frost actually said remains unclear. The possibility of revision is raised by an interview Frost gave to Cleanth Brooks and Robert Penn Warren in 1959, okay, and was subsequently published, as you can see there. So here, in a transcription of the interview that was designed to accompany Brooks and Warren's textbook anthology titled Understanding Poetry, this appeared in 1960, a tremendously widely used textbook in the US. Okay, so here, in this interview, Frost makes a similar statement about translation, but it is much less pointed and much more vague. "I like to say, guardedly, that I could define poetry this way. It is that which is lost out of prose and verse in translation. That means something in the way words are curved and all that. The way words are taken, the way you take the words." So this was near his death, and maybe dementia was at stake, but he didn't let go of this proverb. Okay. All right, Frost obviously saw poetry as a formal feature of both prose and verse. Whether this feature is inherent in language or embedded there by the author is not sharply distinguished in his phrase, "something in the way words are curved." Nor does the rest of Frost's comments clarify the point. In the repetitive phrase, "the way the words are taken, the way you take the words," it sounds like Gertrude Stein. Each instance of the word "take" may mean both selected and arranged by the author and understood or grasped by the author and reader. On the one hand, then, poetry may be inherent in language, an unchanging essence exploited by the author and perceptible to the reader. On the other hand, it may be an effect that depends for its very existence on the author's or reader's particular understanding of language, allowing for the possibility of a response that is not poetic, but that remains the same when that response is poetic. The remarkable thing is that neither concept of poetry affects Frost's idea that translation entails omission. Whether poetry is in essence inherent in the source text or in effect dependent on cognition. He believed that it could not be reproduced or transferred in another language. Hence, his belief in untranslatability assumes an instrumental model of translation. Frost seems to have voiced his famous statement later in his career, but to understand his instrumentalism, we must examine the poetics he formulated decades earlier. In letters written to friends between 1913 and 1915, he described the formal feature that defined poetry in both verse and prose as fundamentally prosodic, using terms such as, these are all quotes, the sound of sense, sentence sound, tone, intonation. He carefully distinguished between grammar, meaning, and meter, as well as the sound of sense, which he considered not only the abstract vitality of our speech, that's a quote, but also, as he put it, the raw material of poetry, such that, and I'm quoting here, if one is to be a poet, he must learn to get cadences by skillfully breaking the sounds of sense with all their irregularity of accent across the regular beat of the meter, end of quote. Although Frost regarded sentence sounds as, I'm quoting again here, very definite entities which are gathered by the ear from the vernacular, their basis for him is not cultural or social, but biological, since they are innate in the species. Here's an example. I'll read this out for you. An example of his thinking. This is from a little letter, isn't that true? A certain number of sentences, sentence sounds, belong to the human throat, just as a certain fixed number of vocal runs belongs to the throat of a given kind of bird. These are fixed, I say. Imagination cannot create them. It can only call them up. It can only call them up for those who write with their ear on the speaking voice. End of quote. Frost asserted at one point that, I'm quoting again, this is no literary mysticism I am preaching, end of quote. But he clearly gave his poetics a metaphysical foundation by grounding language use on a biologism, a transcendental essence that governs the cultural practice here. Ultimately, the poet who attends to sentence sounds does undergo a mystical experience. We summon them from heaven knows where, Frost wrote, under excitement with the audible imagination. End of quote. Although Frost's examples of the sound and sense amounted to English speech rhythms, I should say U.S. English speech rhythms, okay? He occasionally glanced at foreign languages and addressed the question of translating foreign poetry. In a 1915 interview, for example, he used his vernacular poetics to explain the impossibility of translation. I'll read this out for you. Very obscure passage, except to the most obsessed Frost specialist. Nobody today knows how to read Homer and Virgil perfectly, because the people who spoke Homer's Greek and Virgil's Latin are dead as the sound of their language. On the other hand, to further emphasize the impossibility of words rather than sound, conveying the sense of meaning, take the matter of translation. Really, to understand and catch all that is embodied in a foreign masterpiece, it must be read in the original, because while the words may be brought over, the tone cannot be. Frost's, what to call it, phonocentrism. Frost's phonocentrism caused him to impose his own poetics on classical poetry, to assume that, like him, Homer and Virgil drew on sentence sounds in their writing, thereby erasing the cultural and historical differences of their writing. Frost is erasing it. As a result, he believed that when classical poetry is interpreted or translated, as one deferential commentator of his letters observed, I'm quoting here, we lose the poems because we have lost the sounds. Frost was willing to admit that readers conversant in modern languages could appreciate the sentence sounds of modern language poetries, precisely because they had heard the languages spoken, again presuming that his vernacular poetics was universally valued and implemented. Yet not even those poetries can be translated without omitting the formal feature that makes them poetry. The words may be brought over, he says at the end here, a metaphorical expression by which Frost seems to indicate that the lexical meaning of the source text may be communicated in the translated language, but not the tone, because presumably a different language is characterized by a different sound of sense. Thus the statement, poetry is what is lost in translation, requires the assumption of an instrumental model of translation that paradoxically allows Frost to disavow the possibility of translation altogether. He conceived of a literary text as a container of invariance, whether formal, semantic, or effective, which a reader can perceive without interpretation. As Untermeyer reports Frost saying in their conversation, I'm quoting here, a poem means just what it says, and it says what it means, nothing less but nothing more, end of quote. The invariant that defines a poem is prosodic for Frost, sound that nuances meaning. But this formal feature is unavailable to writers and readers who do not speak the language of the poem, and it can never be translated. Without sentence sounds, Frost asserted, this is another quote, we can only write the dreary kind of grammatical prose known as professorial, which is to be seen at its worst in translations, especially from the classics. Frost's instrumentalism prevented him from perceiving aspects of his vernacular poetics that would have challenged his understanding of translation. A classicist, for example, can choose to translate a poem from a classical language into rhythmic prose that cultivates the vernacular, so that the translation avoids a dreary kind of grammatical prose. But since, in Frost's view, sentence sounds are source text invariants that a translation should but could not reproduce or transfer, he was unable to imagine that a translator might command a repertoire of discursive strategies, each giving a different nuance to the source text. Frost would not have comprehended Philip Terry's performance last night. Okay. Frost's instrumentalism, in other words, preempted his thinking of translation as an interpretive act, which produces a text in the translating language that is relatively autonomous from the source text. Even when the translator is an academic specialist in the source language and can therefore maintain a fairly strict semantic correspondence. This point is demonstrated by the only translation that Frost seems ever to have praised. This is, you're going to recognize this immediately, George Herbert Palmer's 1884 version of the Odyssey, which was written in rhythmic prose. In 1934, at the invitation of the editor Edward Weeks, you see this is the book that Frost contributed to. It's essentially a response to a questionnaire. Okay. Frost sent a list of 10 books to be included in this volume, Books We Like, 1936. His first choice in this list was a translation. And here's the passage. Okay, I'll read this out for you. The Odyssey chooses itself, the first in time and rank of all romances. Palmer's translation, again, this is George Herbert Palmer, is by all odds the best. As Lawrence, this is T.B. Lawrence, I'll come back to this, as Lawrence in a preface to his own translation describes the author of the original, he is evidently, we're talking about Homer here, he is evidently a man much more like Palmer than like Lawrence. I can permit myself but one translation out of 10 books. Okay. Frost is referring to T.E. Lawrence's 1932 version of the Homeric epic, which was similarly translated into prose. It was published under the byline of T.E. Shaw. In his preface, Lawrence remarked that, and I'm quoting from Lawrence's here, also T.E. Lawrence, he tried, Lawrence is the translator, he tried to deduce the author from his self-betrayal in the work. Okay. And on the basis of this romantic concept of poetry as authorial self-expression, Lawrence concluded that Homer, I'm quoting here, was very bookish. This housebred man, his work smells of the literary coterie, of a writing tradition, end of quote. Okay. Frost not only agreed with Lawrence's deduction of Homer's personality, but he also knew Palmer, okay, the translator of the translation he loved. He knew Palmer personally, having studied with him at Harvard between 1897 and 1889, when Palmer taught there as professor of philosophy. I'm not going to get into that can of worms. There's something to talk about there. Okay, so Frost's judgment of Palmer's translation then seems to be wholly based on the idea that the translator was as bookish as the author of the Greek text, and that this correspondence between the sensibilities of source author and translator resulted in the best, he calls it the best version. For any reader familiar with Palmer's translation, and you know, they don't exist, let me tell you, for any reader familiar with this translation, Frost appears to have made an egregious error. Palmer assumed a hermeneutic model of translation instead of Frost's instrumentalism. In his preface, he asserted that the Odyssey, I'm quoting here, has as many aspects as it has translators. He acknowledged that the Greek text is capable of supporting multiple and implicitly conflicting interpretations that do not give it back intact. Since the translators, as he put it, sympathies, are sure to reach a limit somewhere, short of the compass of Homer, end quote. Palmer insisted, therefore, that, I'm quoting again, each translator should distinctly state why the poem has attracted him, so that his readers may better understand what elements may, under his treatment, have been forced into undue prominence, end of quote. Palmer seems to have believed that the interpretation inscribed by a translation is partial. Partial in the sense of incomplete in communicating the source text, but also partial in the sense of slanted toward what the translator finds intelligible and interesting. Factors that straddle the knowledge of the source text and culture on the one hand, and an immersion in the translating language and culture on the other. And so, Palmer explained how he transformed the Greek text. This is from his preface. That which I enjoy most in Homer is his peculiar psychology, his unique ethical attitude. Notwithstanding his extraordinary powers of observation and of utterance, he seems to me to confront the world like a child. I turn to him and escape from our complicated and introspective world, and I'm refreshed. Accordingly, I have sought to draw attention chiefly to his simplicity, his realism, his finding joy where a child finds it, to his lack of self-consciousness, his interest in a thing or fact for no more of ulterior reason than because it is a thing or fact. Palmer's interpretation prompted him to distinguish Homer from other epic poets, explicitly mentioning Virgil and Milton, who, he observed, I'm quoting again, were confessedly bookish men, okay, possessing a more highly developed mental condition. To maintain this distinction, he chose to imitate, that's his phrase, imitate. He chose to imitate stylistic features of the Greek text, another quote. Features of the Greek text which characterize the speech of an eager, healthy, sensitive child, including, and he's listing features here, a syntax full of beauty when thought of as that of living speech, end of quote. Accordingly, Palmer preferred to use you instead of thou, okay? Except, as you put it, for prayers and solemn occasions, because he favored, I quote, the diction of speech instead of that of books, end of quote. How, one wonders, could Frost have viewed Palmer's translation as the expression of a bookish Homer, when the translator sought to inscribe an interpretation that was opposed to literary? Was Frost's investment in an instrumental model of translation so deep that he made no effort to locate the living speech in Palmer's writing? Frost failed to recognize the striking resemblance between his own vernacular poetics and Palmer's account of his translation method. Was Frost's instrumentalism so far beyond question that he did not bother to read Palmer's preface? It was a piece of commentary, after all, and that would make it unappealing to a poet so dismissive of interpretation. We can now see that Steiner's belief that for millennia translation theory and commentary have shown a paucity of ideas doesn't quite hold true. Even translation proverbs, despite repeated citation, reveal conceptual differences when their use in specific contexts is taken into account. A certain consistency exists at a more fundamental level, however, an epistemic level that I have called a model of translation, which generates theoretical concepts like untranslatability and discursive practices like sense for sense translation. A model in diverse articulations can enjoy dominance for centuries, only to be subsequently challenged by a different model. Such is the history of the relation between the instrumental and hermeneutic models of translation. The former, emerging in antiquity with commentators like Cicero and Jerome, has dominated thinking about translation into the present, where it is very much dominant. While the latter, the hermeneutic model, first evident in the 19th century in theorists like Friedrich Schleiermacher, initiated a counter-tradition that also extends until today, but that has been limited in development and acceptance, in effect, marginalized. The relation between the two models has long been hierarchical, so that translation theory and commentary can be seen as riddled with contradictions. A particular theoretical statement may be governed by one of these two models, or it may rest on both simultaneously, so that comments about concepts and practices of translation divulge a logical discontinuity at the epistemic level. We are just beginning to realize how productive this line of inquiry might prove to be, but only if we question the conventional wisdom enshrined in translation proverbs. Thank you very much for listening to me. So you might wonder, what does a hermeneutic model of translation look like? Here's one look. I'd be happy to go through this, but there's some time. And I'd like to take questions, please, about anything I've just talked to you about my work. I'll be really foolhardy, too. About translation, if you think I could answer your question. Please, go ahead.
Sure. I was just going to ask you about kind of you brought up very briefly the moral dimension inherent in these models of translation. And one thing that really kind of came home to me was that both models somehow figure in the idea of loss and sort of indebtedness, which, you know, moral relation to some source text. It's really interesting that, you know, talking about especially classic texts, you know, where we always think of this dimension of loss and indebtedness. How do you see those, that idea as kind of underpinning those models? Is that a thread that's worth talking about?
Thank you. Yeah. My first response is no. No. The instrumental model is a hoax. There is no invariant. Is there anyone who's willing to stand up and say in this room that a text cannot support multiple and conflicting interpretations? Be brave. Seriously.
Not directly that, but I was thinking there's another sense of loss that we can think of.
Well, I haven't even got to the loss yet, so hold your question. That's one of my basic assumptions, okay? That's what underlies the notion that translation is interpretation for me. Let me back up. Any text is not available in some direct, unmediated way. It's always already interpreted. OK? Okay, you give me that look like I just walked out of a spaceship. This is one of my basic assumptions. If you put these two together, the first thing you need to do is recognize moralism has no place in translation studies. The hermeneutic model of interpretation is not moral at all. Okay, I'm not here dispensing lessons for conduct. Okay, forget about it. I'm talking about a will to interpretation. It's there. Okay. What do you do with this? It has certain implications. I'll just, mention a couple of them and then take more questions. One implication is you can't just compare a translation to a source text in order to evaluate it. You can't. What should normally happens when that is done is that the person who's doing the comparison never compares the translation to the source text, but compares the translation to that person's interpretation of the source text. In translation, it always takes three to tango. I'm calling the third category interpretance. This is the most neglected category in translation studies, in any thinking about translation, I'm going to suggest. Okay? You can't move from a source text, but let's just generalize this. You can't produce or enact or perform a second order practice on some prior materials, making those prior materials your source materials. You can't produce a translation, an adaptation, an ekphrastic poem, a musical adaptation, a theatrical adaptation, a film adaptation, a museum exhibition, without a set of interpretants. That's what we need to think about with translation. So this, secondly, the second consequence of this, shifts the evaluation of translation to another level completely. We must imagine this, process as happening in specific cultural situations at specific historical moments. The interpretants come from somewhere. They come from the hierarchy of linguistic and cultural values in any period. Translators take stands when they choose words. Those words are not simply verbal choices. They are interpretive moves. We need a new ethics of translation. Okay, I'll stop here. Let's take other questions. Do you want to jump in?
I just wanted to suggest a different understanding of the word lost. Not in the sense of disappearance, but in the sense of being lost.
That may be the translator's interpretation. There may be no loss to the translator. What seems like a loss from one point of view, from the point of view of one model of translation, from the point of view of one concept of equivalence, from another concept may be completely equivalent. There may be no loss. I want to get rid of thinking about loss. Even when the translator omits words, and all translators do, for a variety of reasons, depending on the language pairs. It's an interpretation. What we should be evaluating is the translator's interpretation. Unless you keep assuming that what translation is the reproduction or transfer of an invariant contained in or caused by the source text. An invariant form or formal feature, stylistic or whatever. An invariant meaning, semantic invariant. Or the whole notion of equivalent effect. What a hoax. Okay. You were next, and then Lily. Yeah, sorry.
Would you agree or disagree with the parallel to biological process of translation that happens between RNA, ribonucleic acid, in the cell that's mediated by the ribosome, the cellular machine that performs the translation, into protein? Because protein and ribonucleic acid differ in the number of building blocks that they have. There are 20 amino acids for proteins, there are 4 RNA bases, so there's never a one-to-one translation possible. It's always one-to-many.
Okay, so you want to give me a biological justification for my hermeneutic model. Is that it? I don't need it. You can't change biology. You can take drugs. Okay? But if we're into biology, we are so close to sexism, racism. You really want to go there? Frost was reactionary. He was a great poet. I'm not denying that. You may hate his poetry. I prefer Charles Bernstein to Robert Frost. Okay? But, you know, what an achievement. But thank you for that. I don't want to seem dismissive. I'm impatient. Because instrumental models of translation, notions of invariance, have kept translation and translators back. Okay? This is a story of this is a story of the struggle of every practitioner in this room, and also scholars of translation, whether you want to admit it or not. So at some point you're going to decide whether you're on my side.
I don't want to get sidetracked, but I just really quickly want to footnote on that I think that the idea that by going into dialogue discussion can bring us to sexism and racism and stuff like that it's true, but it also totally depends how we do our biological approach. But it's a footnote. What I really wanted to ask was, I completely agree that it's much more interesting to talk about the interpretive and the variant and stuff like that, and that's totally where my own work goes. But I always get troubled by how did the notion of the variant even come about? How did that even happen?
Sure. This is a great question. Thank you. It depends on the period. It's no accident that Jerome, talk about an achievement, right? To do a translation that had power for centuries. Who does translations like that anymore? Okay? Jerome gave what I call a decisive formulation to an instrumental model when he hardened the dichotomy between word for word and sense for sense translation. And of course, sense for sense was where he put his money, Jerome. And it's clearly instrumental because he assumes that all the translator has to do is read the text and, that semantic invariant contained in the text will be immediately apparent to the translation. This is a guy who's translating the Bible. So he's dismissing, even in the early Christian church, competing interpretations of the Bible and so forth. Not to mention heresies and all that stuff. In any case, it's no accident that one of the most important statements in the instrumental model understood translation as divine revelation. Instrumentalism is metaphysics. Okay? I mean, that's, I think, if I'm, my thinking is coming out of a tradition clearly that is a critique of metaphysics. Ha, no surprise, right? My heroes are not simply Schleiermacher, but Charles Peirce, hence the term interpretant, which I've, been reformulating here, I hope, and Derrida. I want to distinguish my hermeneutic model from the tradition of philosophical hermeneutics. Okay? Schleiermacher, I'm willing to get in bed with. He's complicated. But when it comes to Heidegger and Gadamer, forget it. They're essentialists. There's a lot there to think about that could help us think about translation. But when they start talking about translation, something breaks down. And they become fascists. That's one way to put it. So, okay. Other questions, please. You and then you. Go ahead, you in the back.
Thanks very much for that. I was illuminated by all of that, but particularly some of the things you were saying about the Jacobson essay, which I've taken as, it's a beautiful essay, and it's, I've kind of taken it as gospel for a long time, but the way you were talking about the kind of sleight of hand in that, I was kind of really interested in, and it's kind of obvious point, but what he says about poetry, equating poetry with puns, is kind of a weird thing to say in the first place, because poetry is clearly more than puns, but also to prove that he reduces the Italian pun and says that's untranslatable, whereas it clearly is translatable, maintaining that pun. You could translate it as translator, traitor.
Right.
And it's not different.
Right.
And it keeps the pun, sort of just that one.
Yes. Thank you. Please.
Well, I'm taking notes in your talk. I was trying to play with the notion of proverb. I thought that was an interesting way to frame the talk, and I wondered if you had thought about trying to make a more open proverb that wouldn't close down. That would have, I mean, I took notes, like, in translation, it takes three to tango, interpretation, I just wanted to throw that out there as a poet.
Thanks, yeah. I like to do this, you know, even though I'm an academic. My books have been considered non-academic books by other academics, but, you know, who cares? I want to resist the notion of language that produces an illusionism. And for that reason, proverbs, you know, in itself, the whole genre of proverb I find deeply questionable. However, imagine a poem, Charles, my brother, poem like this, Charles Bernstein, that's just a series of proverbs that are contradictory and, you know, wigged out and whatever, or the whole form of the proverbs kind of unravels. That might be interesting. That's why I began by trying to suggest that my whole definition of cliché was contingent on this interpretive occasion. That there are other ways to define what a cliché is, and it could be great poetic material, a cliché, depending on what you do with it. So I don't want to, you know, stop that, you know, from happening. I think the thing for me is that what thinking about translation proverbs allows me to do is cross the boundary. One of the things is cross the boundary between elite and popular cultural constituencies. Because no matter where a commentator on translation might be situated, they use these proverbs. And they use them in the most unthinking way. The most theoretically sophisticated scholars in literary and cultural studies are using these things. Okay, so it's partly a kind of polemical gesture, which I tend to favor. But you know, I want to, you know, change the way people think about translation. That's why I'm here. Okay. Yes.
I'm speaking definitely as somebody on your side. So
okay.
You said that I
good.
I'm
right. Give me your address.
However, I'm slightly worried that itself might be a cliche. The difference between instrumentalism and hermeneutic might itself be possible of pushing itself.
Okay, good. Thank you. This distinction was made, I think it was early 1970s, by a Canadian linguist named Louis Kelly, who wrote a book called The True Interpreter, which is a kind of history of translation commentary, thinking about translation. However, although he writes about translation and has even, you know, contributed to the Oxford History of Literary Translation, and did a very literary piece, he is a linguist. And he looked at these two notions of translation, which he defined differently from me, as complementary. They're not, at least not the way I describe them and conceptualize them. Okay. I mentioned at the end of my talk that they have existed in a hierarchical relationship since antiquity, worldwide, not simply in the West. I've only spoken about Cicero and Jerome. You can find this in ancient Chinese translation on commentary, on translating the Buddhist scriptures, for instance. You find instrumental models. My whole idea is that the hierarchy exists. It's not something that I've invented. Okay? The hierarchy limits thinking about translation as an interpretive act. I see it everywhere. In my students, when I submit a paper to a journal, whatever, I get a book review. My object is, first of all, to say that this needs to be inverted, this hierarchy. Okay? That the most value in our thinking about translation should be assigned to a hermeneutic model. But the next step is to allow the hermeneutic model to invade the field. There is no instrumentalism. it doesn't exist. It's a hoax. It's easy to show that there is no invariant. It's easy to show how an instrumental assumption limits thinking, limits evaluation, limits description and explanation of translations. So what I'm going to do is a deconstruction of the hierarchy. Okay? And I'm going to tell you that I'm going a step further than Derrida here. Instrumentalism doesn't exist. Oddly enough, Derrida is locked within an instrumental model of translation. Shocked, huh? That paradox, nothing is translatable, but everything is translatable, that rests on an instrumentalism. He never got out of that. Derrida, of course, may have done this intentionally. Brilliant man. He may have done it intentionally because his idea was we can never finally get rid of metaphysical thinking. Hence, you know, strange things like crossing out the verb to be in his texts. Okay? So maybe he thought there was no way out of fundamental thinking about translation. I would say that his own work showed that that's not the case. That Derrida performed translation as an interpretive act. Take a look at the essay, What is a Relevant Translation? Where he translates into French certain key passages from Shakespeare's Merchant of Venice, and then explains, you know, why he chose this word, relève, to translate the English word season, to season. It's clear, he's got an elaborate set of interpretants in that verbal choice. He's doing much, much more than just a mechanical substitution of one word for another because he thinks it's equivalent. His choice of relève is doing the work of interpretation. So. Please, you know, let's talk. I'm going to be here for a while. You know, buy me a drink, I'll talk longer.
We have